Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Trusted opponent, ladies and gentlemen, we're very happy to be back again tonight for this service we feel we're rendering to this community, to this people. I don't think I have ever been in a discussion where we had better order than we've had here. I made the statement to some that I have seen worse order, or maybe I shouldn't have put it like that, but we're having better order here than I have seen in some church services, and it's commendable, and I'm very grateful, and I hope it continues. Both sides have been very orderly, and I'm very grateful. You heard our moderator as he announced my subject that I find the Holy Spirit baptism is for believers today as in the days of the apostles. By believer, I mean one that has been converted, has been saved from past committed sins. We call it the new birth. There's a vast difference in the birth of the Spirit and the baptism of the Spirit. I want to start tonight with Acts 2, where the Apostle Peter said, Acts 2:17, "And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh." Our friend, the Bible states that very plainly. It needs no explanation. God said it. That should settle it. But in the last chapter of Acts, chapter 28, verse 26, it says, "Some believe and some believe not." That has been the condition since the days of Cain and Abel. I'm going to quote one verse now. If you'll believe this one verse, you'll be the one I thought it meant. In Romans 3:3, it said, "What if some do not believe? Shall their unbelief make the truth of God of none effect? I tell you, nay. Let God be true, and every man a liar." Every man means your father, your husband, your brother, your minister, whoever he may be. Now, God said in Acts 2:17, "And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, I will pour out my Spirit." If any man says that isn't true, let him be a liar and believe God. It says it. Before I go further with this, I want to answer some statements that my opponent made about me. One, he said, "Mr. Batts is full of mistakes and blunders and scramblings." I wish he'd take some of them. The Bible said, when you judge others, you're guilty yourself, and so listen to one of his scrambling, as he called it, and mistakes and blunders. He said, "Not a word in the Bible about the unknown tongue." In 1 Corinthians 14:2, speaking of the language of the Spirit, he said, "No man understandeth him. Howbeit in the Spirit, he speaketh mysteries." Then if no man understands it, then it is unknown. And this is not in italics. It was given by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Then he said again, "Only apostles received the Holy Ghost in Acts 2:4. He said, "Only apostles were there." And he read some verses from the first chapter of Acts down to and skipped. Oh yes, he said there was not 120 there. I want you to listen as I read now. "Then returned they," I'm reading 12 verse, "unto Jerusalem,
from the Mount of Olives unto from Jerusalem, the Sabbath day's journey. And when they, whoever they were, come in, they went up in the upper room where abode the apostles. They were already there when they came in, where they abode. Then he named them. In the next verse, these all continued, whoever they were that went in where the apostles were. These all continued in one accord, a concert prayer, which he called the frog pond last night. Everybody praying was the frog pond. These all continued in prayer and supplication with the women and with Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. And in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples, not in the midst of the apostles. The apostles were there, and they were disciples, and there were other disciples, men and women. The number, about 120. Apostles, men and women, including the mother of our Lord Jesus Christ. Then, brethren, Peter said, listen closely to this man. And Peter said, when the Holy Ghost came, this is that which was spoken of by the prophet Joel. Now, do you believe that? We'll turn back to Joel 2:28, and Joel didn't say he'll pour it out on 12 apostles. He said, on maids and handmaids and servants. And the sons and daughters, apostles and disciples combined, about 120 were there. And these all continued in concert prayer, all in one accord, all praying at one time. And the Holy Ghost came, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. We'll get to that speaking in tongues there that he made mention of just a little later. I'm talking now about some of this bungling and mistakes. And he said that Joel did not say the last day. Joel did say in the last days. I said he did not. And you know, I read it again today, brother, and it still does not read last days in Joel 2. You know, after he said that last night, you'd think perhaps it did. So I read it today, and it still said it should come to pass afterward. Why did Joel say afterward? He had just made mention of the fact that Jesus would walk in the midst of Israel. We call it walking the shores of Galilee and so forth and so on. He walked among them and then he ascended. And after he walked and ascended, Joel said, afterward he will pour out his spirit upon all flesh. And when he ascended, these disciples returned to Jerusalem. Men and women, as Joel said there would be, and as Acts 1 said there were, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. He said only the apostles had power to lay hands on people to receive the Holy Ghost. If you'll find that in the Bible, yes, I've got a car it's paid for. I'll give that to you, brother. If you'll find in the Bible where it said only apostles had power to lay hands on people and impart the Holy Ghost, I'll give you my car with a clear deed. That's about all I've got to offer. Now, I want to say that no apostle had that power to impart the Holy Ghost for the imposition of hands. If they did, why didn't they preach to them? And why didn't they pray with them? Why didn't they just go around touching people and they receive the Holy Ghost? They only aided those who were converted and were hungry and seeking God. Jesus said, they that do hunger and thirst will be filled. The disciples at Samaria received the word of God, repented, baptized in water, and had not received the Holy Ghost. And Peter and John came down to pray for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. And I believe they prayed because the Bible said that's what they came for. And I believe they laid hands on them. But they couldn't lay hands on just anybody because Simon in that service didn't receive the Holy Ghost that night. And someone will tell you because he wasn't an apostle. But Peter said the reason He couldn't have the power because his heart was not right with God. He said, Ananias did not lay hands on Paul to receive the Holy Ghost. Now, the Bible doesn't say lay, but said, putting his hands upon him, said, the Lord sent me that you might receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. You said, well, the Bible doesn't say that he was filled. Well, does it say that anyway? Yet we know he was filled somewhere. He said, I came that you may receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And when he laid hands on him, the Bible said the scales fell from his eyes. It didn't say he did or did not receive the Holy Ghost, but he received it somewhere. And you believe, if you'll be honest, he received it right there, for he said that's what God sent him over there for. Amen. So Simon was not an apostle, so far as I know, not even an evangelist or exhorter. Just said a certain man, Simon, who lived over there in that community. And God told him to go out. And he went out putting his hands upon him and said, the Lord sent me that you might receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. Then another scripture he read all around the 33rd verse in John 3:33 and skipped it. I'm going to read the 32nd, 33rd, and the 34th. Jesus said, and what he has seen and heard, that he testified, that's referring to Jesus. Then he turns to men, and no man receiveth his Christ's testimony. The 33rd verse said, he, talking about any man, he that receiveth his Christ's testimony has set to his seal that God is true. And this word set to his seal means that he had received a stamp of approval or a mark. And in the stamp of approval and this mark, completely satisfied him that God was true. And the next verse, for, or because, he whom God has sent speaketh the words of God, for God giveth not the Spirit by measure. Now the words unto him, as we said, are in our times. God did not say unto him, he just said, he whom God sends, speak God's word for, because God giveth not his Spirit by measure. The Holy Spirit's not divided, he's one. You either have him or you do not have him. Last night he accused me of blaspheming for saying that Jesus is our pattern example. Brother Nichols, from one of the churches here today, a friend bought a song book on page 220. The choir sings the song and said, he, referring to Christ, is our great example and pattern for me. So you have indicted the Church of Christ people in this community as being blasphemers. You thought you were indicting me. They may not come to hear you here Saturday night, Sunday afternoon. In Romans 8 and 9, where in a man has not the Spirit, he's none of his. If you notice that word have in the original Greek, it's have relation or being accompanied by the Holy Spirit. Every convert has the Holy Spirit with him, even before he's converted. He is convicted by the Spirit. He is born of the Spirit. He is sanctified by the Spirit, and that same Spirit, after he convicts and converts and sanctifies us all, he wants to come in and fill the body and bury and baptize the soul. Now, wait a minute. Didn't Jesus say in John 14:17 to converts, he is with you and shall be in you? He was with them because they were converted. The name's on the book of life. He was with them because they were preaching, even performing miracles. But Jesus said, he will be in you.
distinguished moderators, ladies and gentlemen, and greetings to all of you in this fine evening. It is a joy to be back again to study these great questions. I want to notice my friend's speech briefly here, and then present some negative material. First of all, he says that good order has prevailed, and I want to endorse that. If I didn't say something about it, you might think that I did not agree with that statement. But I do most heartily. I haven't been disturbed by anybody, and I'm sure he has not, and everything has been so orderly. It is wonderful this time to be here and a part of this investigation of God's Word. In Acts 2:17, my friend says that Peter said that I will pour out of my spirit, saith the Lord, in the last days. That Peter said that, making it future tense at the time Peter preached on Pentecost. And that Joel did not say that God would pour out the Spirit on Pentecost. The Pentecost was not in the last days. That the Holy Spirit has been poured out down here in modern times. That this is last days. But I want you to notice that the Apostle Peter is quoting from Joel 2. He said, these are not drunken as you suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And then he starts the quotation. And it shall come to pass in the last days. So God, the Lord God said. He said it in Joel 2:28. Now, for him, thinks that God is just now saying that through Peter for the first time. And now, why did Peter go back and quote from Joel? If it was Joel who was going to pour out the Spirit hereafter instead of God, then notice what Joel said. He said it shall come to pass hereafter that I will pour out of my Spirit. He is speaking for God then. Holy men of God, spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost, 2 Peter 1:21. God which sends a time, and about as manner taken time passed over the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken to us by a son, Hebrews 1:1. It was God speaking through Noah of Joel. And therefore, when Peter said, that saith God, he's quoting from Joel 2:28. He goes on and quotes in verse 21 from Joel 2:28-32. And it's not the very words of Joel, not all the way down through. None of the verses, hardly, if any, are just word for word, because Peter is quoting from the Septuagint translation, which Christ and the apostles used, which the New Testament used in the Old Testament, throughout the first century. A text translation made by 70 Greek scholars before the birth of Christ. And he's quoting from that, which said last days instead of hereafter. And it's a part of the quotation. And he wants it to mean that I'll pour out of my spirit way down here in the 19th century, in the last 100 years, he said last night. In the last 100 years. And he's perverted and yet claims to be guided by the Holy Spirit like the apostles. And therefore he's wrong as wrong can be about it. And then again, he said that I made the statement that he was full of blunders. Please send me that other sheet there. Some of concerning blunders that he has made. I will give you a few of his blunders, since he has challenged me to show some of them. He said, there are no measures of the Spirit. But John 3:34 says, God giveth not the Spirit but measure unto him. The Lord says, you can't put any confidence in that unto him. The him there is not in the original Greek, it's italicized. Do you pay any attention to Hebrews 2:9? Where that the word man is italicized? That he by the grace of God should take death for every, and then man is italicized. Did Christ die for somebody besides men and leave us out? Do you pay any attention to it? And then in this very speech, according from 1 Corinthians 14, and the first verse is about the unknown term. Unknown term, and the word unknown is not in the original, it's italicized. Now, I challenge you to look at it. The words unknown, term, are not in the original. They're supplied words in some translations, most foreign terms. He can speak it in a foreign term. There's no such thing as a tongue that's unknown to everybody on earth. Why, you couldn't have a language or a tongue that nobody knows anything about. And so when he says in this chapter 14 to 1 Corinthians that no man understandeth him, he means nobody when he's speaking in a tongue out of order, when there's no interpreter. Nobody can explain to the audience what he's saying. Why then, of course, no man understands him when he's up there speaking in a language that the people don't understand, and he's forbidden to do it. If there be no interpreter, let him keep silence, and they are leaving. They can even let him go on and jabber, and they call that speaking in a tongue. They're not doing a thing on earth, they're just jabbering. But now on Pentecost, when they spoke in a foreign tongue, what's called an unknown tongue, to them, they hadn't learned this language. But they're beginning in verses 5 and 6, and they were dwelling at Jerusalem, Jews devout men out of every nation under heaven. And when this was going abroad, the multitude came together. They were not there when this started. The multitude came together, and then it goes on to tell us that they were confounded because of every man heard them speak in his own language. In his own language. And then they said, how dare we every man in our own tongue? Wherein we were born, Parthians, Elamites, dwellers of Mesopotamia, the Cappadocian, and Pontus, and Asian, parts of Libya, about Cyrene, strangers of Rome, Jews, proselytes, Greeks, and Arabians, we do hear them speak in our tongue the words and works of God. That's the only sort of an unknown tongue in the Bible. This jabbering is not in there, except to be condemned. They're not allowed to even pray in an unknown tongue, for they couldn't say amen if by giving a thanks. Everything's to be done intelligently. 1 Corinthians 14, 4 to that same chapter. Let all things be done decently and in order. And not only so, but verse 33. God is not the author of confusion. And that's exactly what you fellows have. You're the author of confusion. He even argued it here in this speech a while ago. I'm talking about praying in unison. Said they prayed in unison there in Acts, the first chapter. Well, if they all prayed at the same time, they must have had a leader and had sentence prayer. That's the only kind of praying that you could have when everybody is speaking, would be for someone to express a sentence and then all of them together say that. Now, they may have had that sort of thing, and that would be like singing. That would not be disorderly. Sentence prayer. But I challenge you to prove that they all like frogs in the millpond, like you will argue for it. One saying this in prayer and praying this way and another praying that way and just such a mess as that. God is not the author of that, sir. I challenge you to try to defend that here tonight. In your next speech, you can't do it. And you know you can't do it. All right, then. I bring this charge against him. He says there are no measures of the Spirit. Well, if there are no measures of the Spirit, why then, heaven's going to largely be populated, according to him, by people who never have had the Holy Spirit. Because he says you don't have to have it to go to him. I tell you to say in your next speech that a man has to have the Holy Spirit to go to heaven. I believe that he doesn't. I believe that Jude's statement, Jude 19, essential, having not the Spirit. I don't believe a man go to heaven without the Spirit, but he doesn't believe anybody has the Spirit except just a few people who he says have been baptized in the Holy Ghost and talk with tongues. According to him, you can't go to heaven unless you talk the tongue. I challenge you to say you can go to heaven without talking in tongues. And without the Holy Spirit baptism. And I challenge you to say that you can't. Just either one. Now you watch and he'll not say either one. I'm predicting, and he'll not. If he does, he'll wish he had. Either one. Doesn't make a difference to me. He'll wish he had. And then he has three baptisms in force today. He has water baptism in force today, and Holy Ghost baptism in force today, and then he also has an imaginary baptism that the Bible doesn't say a word about in force today, which is some sort of an imaginary sort of a baptism that takes place when a man believes, one time he said when he believes, and another time when he repents. For one time he said you're saved the very moment you believe, and another time he said it's the very moment you repent. And I asked him some questions, and he refused to answer that one and skipped it. Is a man saved twice, once when he believes and the other time when he repents? So does he both believe and repent at the same split second? Or either is he saved twice? And you know, he wouldn't even read that one the other night, he skipped it. He practiced the Passover. And then another blunder, he said a man, a sinner, can be saved yet. Even yet can be saved according to the Old Testament scriptures. By the Old Testament, then Christ died in vain, and the New Testament's in vain, and Christianity is vain, and Judaism is good as Christianity. They'll say the same as Christianity. I'd be ashamed to be afraid, and afraid to be ashamed not to reprove that sort of false teaching. It isn't true. He's made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter. 2 Corinthians 3 and 6. But this man says you can be a minister of the Old Testament and be just as good as the New Testament as far as salvation is concerned. Yet be saved according to the Old Testament scriptures, same as by the New Testament scriptures. You don't have to follow the New Testament. Then he also blundered when he said that the New Testament is enforced before the death of Christ. Hebrews 9, 16 and 17. He blundered when he said the Old Testament ended at John. I showed that it was not. Christ kept the Passover and the Sabbath and taught other people to obey the law after the John. And he blundered when he said that the blood of Christ is shed because of remission of sins. When Hebrews 9:22 said without shedding of blood is no remission. He blundered when he said that the Spirit that one could go to heaven, when he argues that a man could go to heaven without the Holy Spirit. The children of God don't have to have the Holy Spirit. They didn't say you have to have a Holy Spirit baptism to go to heaven. He hasn't said it yet. He hasn't said it in the sanctuary. In fact, I believe I'll read you a little statement from his, and I thought I had the page turned down here. Maybe I had it. One here concerning the Old Testament. He says, we believe in the whole Bible rightly divided, and in taking the New Testament as our only rule of faith and practice. Then last night said you could say according to the Old Testament. See how he blunders? And I could go on and on. He said that the Church of Christ does not believe in repentance. That's a blunder and a slander against the Church of Christ. And he said, he blundered when he said that man is baptized in Christ. I challenge you to give the verse of Scripture that says it. I am in Christ. He said a man is baptized in the one body. I challenge you to show that. Where's the passage that says? I can give you a passage that says we're baptized into Christ. But to be baptized in Christ is a different thing. And then he said that no man baptized in anything except into anything except into water. Into water. Well, a man not baptized into water. He's baptized in water. He doesn't know the difference in into and in. He's baptized in water. So you went down into the water. I took him in, and still I'm baptized, and then it says, and he baptized him, and then they came up out of the water. So if we were baptized in Christ, why we'd get in Christ, into Christ, and then we'd have to come up out of Christ, for there's a resurrection in the baptism that puts us into Christ. Hence, you'd just be in Christ the split moment that you're under the water. Under whatever he says it is, you just stay in Christ as the element, you just be in him long enough to be baptized. You'd like to be in the water just long enough to be baptized. And then you'd come away from it, out of that. You'd be away from Christ, if Christ is the element. But Romans 6:3-4 makes baptism a condition of salvation because it's into Christ and has a burial and a resurrection in it. He has no resurrection in the baptism he talks about. I call attention to another blunder or two here. In John 3:34, that he giveth not the spirit of measure. He read the context there, and the context didn't contradict it. Not one word. I read the context last night and read the proper verses. He read down there where some fellow that heard Christ said that he could bear witness that Christ was speaking from God. Yes, because that Christ had the spirit without measure, and Matthew 12:28 says, out of the spirit of God cast out devils. And when Christ could perform miracles, that confirmed his word, and his people would believe in him and say he came from God. He's written it to my sleeve. John 20:30-31. And the Holy Spirit guides us into all truth. And yet they're divided, teaching contradictory doctrines. Thanks for listening.
My opponent really went a long ways around to get back on water baptism again tonight, didn't he? Now, this is supposed to be the second night on the Holy Spirit. Someone said about the first night, he is a genius when it comes to camouflaging. But his message tonight, and since we finished, supposed to finish on water baptism, reminds me one time of the caretaker found a note in the pastor's church, and this outline he preached that Sunday morning had a big cross mark there, and he noticed it said, "Strong emphasis here. Your point's weak." So that's what the brother Nichols is doing, placing strong emphasis where it points weak. Now, I haven't accused my opponent of being ignorant, haven't reflected on his intelligence, but I do want to ask him this question. If you notice what the word "and" means, in Acts 2:16-17, Peter said this, that's present, what we have right here, you're asking about. This is that spoken of by the prophet Joel, and conjunction, in addition to this, something to follow after, and it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God. I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. The Apostle Peter is simply stating there will be a repetition of Pentecost in the last days. Joel predicted the former rain and the latter rain. The fifth chapter of James used the very word "last days." The husband is waiting for the precious fruit of the earth until he receives the latter rain. He spoke of something newfangled, urging you good people, you're in a kingdom that cannot be shaken. That had a psychological undertone. Of course, I realized it. In other words, don't you church of Christ people be shaken when you fangle something. Well, I said, this, we've been in this latter end about 100 years, and that's about how long you've been hearing water baptism in the church of Christ. The church of Christ, you haven't heard it at least that long. And if you just turn to an encyclopedia, Britannica, and any other reliable encyclopedia, they'll tell you its origin, who started it, and what church he was thrown out of that started it. Now, he asked for that, calling it newfangled. In the New Testament church, they were saved before water baptism, and he knows it, and you know it. Oh, yes, you do. If you'll be honest, you know it. Now, and Peter said there on maids and handmaids. Not only apostles, and Joel said that too. And Peter simply saying, it won't only be for the preachers in the last days, the women, even the servants, the maids. And then he said, servant, on my servants. Now, nobody but servants of God received the Holy Ghost. God said, I pour it out on my servants, not church members. On my servants. That does not mean that every servant of God has received the baptism. There are some servants of God in 19th chapter of Acts have not received it. The 8th chapter of Acts. Until a certain time. You have to believe in it and desire it and put the kingdom of God first. And the Bible said the kingdom of God is joy and peace in the Holy Ghost. My friend, if in the days of the apostles on the day of Pentecost, that was the last days, as he's insisting, surely we're living in the last days now. And Peter didn't say he poured this out in the first part of the last days. Let's just see how flimsy his argument is, how inconsistent his doctrine is, how he contradicts himself. And you know, if you play the record tonight, you'd have the tape. I did not use the word unknown tongues. If I did, born out, I will apologize. I know the word unknown is in the italics. The translators thought they were helping us, and it didn't hurt any, and it didn't help any. They could have left it out. Here's what God said. No man understandeth him. And I didn't even use the word unknown. You don't have to use it. Now, he called it jabbering. After service last night, I said, Brother Nichols, I hope you don't blaspheme the Holy Ghost if you haven't already. Now, friends, you may not believe it, but your speaker has received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He's dwelling in my body now. Now, on the day of Pentecost, Brother Nichols, the Bible said, others mocked. Brother Nichols, did you get that? On the day of Pentecost, and you know who they were? The leading religious people of the town mocked. Now, he said they understood. I want you to listen closely, friend. He said there were only 12 there, but the Bible says about 120 men and women. Now, listen. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues. Listen now. As the Spirit gave them the utterance. Now, when this happened, not a one of the 17 nations were there. They certainly wouldn't be talking in their language before they arrived. At this time, they were not talking to the 17 nations, they were talking to God. And God said, when you're talking to God, no man understands it. In the Spirit, he speaketh mystery. Then they go on, am I speaking, or the Spirit speaking through me about the mysteries of God and talking direct to God? Put away your preconceived ideas, friends, and your unbelief, and enjoy the heavenly benefits God has provided for these last days. Now listen. Listen now. There's a vast difference in the language of speaking to God that no man understands. Now don't miss this now. And the gift of tongues. All who receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit speaking the language to God that no man understands. But a comparative few ever speak by the gift of tongues. When you're speaking by the gift of tongues, it's the same Holy Spirit, but you're talking to people and not unto God. When you're speaking by the gift of tongues, at 1 Corinthians 14:27, it is to be one or two, the most of them. But when you're talking to God, 120 may talk at one time. The 10th chapter of Acts, the Holy Ghost said, all that heard the word, for we heard them speak the tongues. Not the 17 nations, they weren't there. They were talking to God. He said, for, because, seeing, knowing, they speaking in a language we don't understand, we know they had the Holy Ghost. The 19th chapter of Acts, there's no need of the gift of tongues there, and there was no manifestation of the gift of tongues. But there was a manifestation of the fact that they had received the gift of the Holy Ghost. He said, I don't remember just how he said, don't have to have the Holy Ghost to go to heaven. Well, I want to tell you now, friend, there'll be multiplying thousands in heaven who've never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, nor the fullness of the Spirit, as you call it, as the Bible refers to as a baptism. Everybody that is born of the Spirit is a child of God and in the kingdom of God, and that they don't backslide, they'll go to heaven. The Holy Ghost has not given me to perform miracles, not given me to shout. He's given to me as a comforter and power giver and a guide. and for several things I could discuss if I had time, but don't have time right now. All the saints go to heaven. Now he quoted 2 Corinthians 3:6. If you notice 1 Corinthians 3:6, by being able ministers of the gospel, not of the letter, he stated plainly, Paul did there, the letter engraved on stone, speaking of the Ten Commandments and not of the book of Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Joel, and any of the prophecies. The letter, the law written on tables of stone, is abolished, he said. It's ended. It's a dead letter. The gospel has replaced it. But listen to this, children. The church is built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Thank you. I have a big subject to start in on now. I don't have time for it, so I need all the time, but 15 minutes. But he said there's nothing in the Bible about the unknown tongue, and he made mention that a while ago that every language is by human knowledge or ability. And there's no such thing as the divine language that we can talk to God by the power of the Spirit. Well, that's the open contradiction and an indictment against God, the Holy Ghost, and the Bible. Because the Bible plainly says they're speaking by the Spirit as he gives utterance, and we're talking about the mysteries of God. And the Bible says, he that speaketh in the tongue, I'll leave off the word unknown there because I don't need it in italics there too, edifies himself. The word edify means to build up, to broaden, to strengthen, to encourage. He that speaketh in tongues to God that no man understands is building up himself. And that's what Jude said, build up yourself praying in the Holy Ghost. Paul said, I'll pray in the Spirit, and I'll pray with my understanding also. But when I pray with the Spirit, my understanding is unfruitful. Not my prayer. My prayer is fruitful, builds me up. But my understanding, I don't understand the word I'm saying. But there's one thing I know, I'm being built up. And the Apostle Paul, a member of the Church of Christ, said, thank God, I speak with tongues more than you all. Not more tongues now. Tongues more. Than you all. And he said, I would that you all speak with tongues. Certainly they didn't all speak in tongues. They didn't all have the baptism. They weren't all even sanctified. They didn't all incarnate belong to the same church he wrote to. Watch it closely. Under the Church of God incarnate, to them were sanctified, called to be saints, will all them that in every place call on God, both theirs and ours. He's their God, he's our God. We're calling on God, we're calling on God. So that's a general letter written directly to the Church of God and indirectly to all others that are calling upon God. Amen. Now, friends, Jesus Christ spoke in tongues. Every writer of the New Testament spoke in tongues. The Bible said, if you believe, you speak in tongues. He said, if you believe, the mouth will be damned. It's the sign of the unbeliever. It builds up the one that's speaking. What kind of sign is it? Jesus, speaking of this, that these signs shall follow them. The word them is the group of believers. Jesus said that if you find true believers, you find these signs among the believers. And if you don't have in Alabama a group of these signs following them, we're still all unbelievers today. Because it's the language of the Lord Jesus Christ. In my next 15 minutes, I'm going to spend the entire 15 minutes on the evidence of receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And there is a lot of different things in the gift of tongues and the devotional tongue. The gift of tongues is to people to be interpreted by someone having the gift of interpretation, and the devotional tongue is talking to God and not unto man. Amen. In Isaiah 28:11, he prophesied this. He said, with stammering lips and other tongues, and Paul referred to that in 1 Corinthians 14, and endorse the fact that Isaiah was talking about the very same thing he was talking about.
Moderators, ladies and gentlemen, it affords me great pleasure to reply to the remarks of my friendly friend, whom I'm learning to like more and more as far as a man's concerned. I have nothing but hatred for his doctrine. David said, through thy precepts I get understanding, and therefore I hate every false way. Psalms 119, verse 104. He wants to know several things here. He said, I got back on baptism. Well, he's back on it, talking about it too. And that somebody said so and so to him. I will insist that he's violating the rules in this discussion. We signed rules that we would do everything within our power to promote to harmony and good order in our congregation, and not to lead the congregation into any participation in this discussion. And he's been constantly bringing up here something somebody said. Might have run him so crazy he couldn't sleep tonight if I'd tell him what all the things I hear about him, but I'm not going to be backbiting around here and slandering and insinuating and things of the sort. If he'll let it alone, but if he doesn't, I may unload on him and tell some things I've heard and sort of do as Solomon said, answer a man according to his folly. Now then, he said, what does and mean? He needs to learn, because in Acts 2:38, when we were on that, Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for remission of sins. And he said that meant repent in order to remiss your sins, and then be baptized because you already got it. It's preposition forward, backward and forward, both. No scholar on earth will endorse that sort of thing. Everybody knows it. What does and mean in Mark 16:16? He that believeth and is baptized to be saved. And is baptized. He that believeth and, I told him a night or so ago what and meant, that it meant plus. One and one equal two. It's the same as one plus one equal two. And mean plus. Sir, don't you know that? That it means plus? All right. Why didn't you let it be plus in Acts 2:38? Repent for remission of sin, but it says also be baptized for remission in that same passage. Why'd you let it be there? Backfires on you. Now the word and is the first word in Joel 2:28. And it shall come to pass, said God. And Peter is pulled from Joel 2:28, and it begins with and. First word. Now, do you know what it means? Look at the first word there. I'm sure that I'm right about it. All right, thank you for wiggling your head. All right, then, why didn't you say it? Why didn't you say and is a part of Joel's statement? And it shall come to pass, saith God, and it is beginning a quotation from Joel 2:28. And in the last days I pour out of the Spirit, or in the last days I pour out of my Spirit on all flesh. And all flesh here in the last days didn't end with Pentecost. That's why that the handmaidens were mentioned. Philip had some virgin daughters who prophesied. The Holy Spirit had no doubt fallen upon them. Acts 19:6 shows that by the laying on of the apostles' hands, men were able to prophesy. But he brought up the question of prophesy and prophets a while ago. Said that the church was built upon the prophets, the prophets. He meant the Old Testament prophets. Because he was right then trying to defend his doctrine that the plan of salvation is in the Old Testament, same as it is in the New Testament. But Ephesians 4:8 says of Christ, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men and gave some to be apostles and some P-R-O-P-H-E-T-S. That's New Testament prophets. And Ephesians, the third chapter, and verse 5, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets of the Spirit, and like Mark and Luke, the prophets of God, and Peter, and Stephen, no doubt. They were prophets of God. Acts 19 and 6. They prophesied when Paul laid his hands on them. They needed prophets in the New Testament church. Some teachers there, besides apostles. They couldn't be everywhere where they were needed at once. And then again, he said, James speaks of the last days. Why, I didn't know that.
I may be ignorant, but I don't remember a thing in James about last days. Now you read that.
The latter rain there has no reference to last days. You prove that that means last days even, instead of a serpent. And so he got off on who started the church. Well, he admits that the church he is a member of was started by man. I think he does. I think he does. I know he can't identify it with the one in the Bible. In doctrine, you can see that throughout this debate. It's not in harmony with the Bible church on doctrine. I can tell you who started the church, of which I remember, the one that the Lord added me to when I obeyed the gospel. Acts 2:47, the Lord added the church. Christ said, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And then, that's what Christ said, I will build my church. And then Paul said, the churches of Christ salute you, Romans 16:16. And they're called churches of God too, but those churches of God back there are not like his outfit. There are no kin to that, no identity to that. But watch some of the points in which that's true. And notice how he begs the question. He said, there's joy and peace in the Holy Ghost. In Romans 14, he didn't give the reference, but Romans 14, maybe 17. Yes, but that didn't say in the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You need Christians that say it's the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He needs to prove his doctrine instead of asserting it. And he said, no man understands him, and therefore he's just jabbering, you know. And nobody would understand him. It was not a real language. That, in the final analysis, it doesn't mean any language at all. Only God could know what he was driving at. Well, the Bible says that no man would understand him if he talked or prayed before the congregation, leading a prayer or making a speech, trying to edify people who did not understand his foreign language, whether it came from God or whether that it was his native foreign tongue. It'd be out of order for him to be in here in an assembly in Colorado, where that they had all various types of nationalities of people. But he doesn't know that. He says, I testify that I have received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Your testimony is no good. I can prove there are Catholics all over the world. But a priest can pray away sin. They can testify just as earnestly as you do that a priest can pardon their sins. Joseph Smith claimed to be a prophet of God. I don't believe a word of it. Mary Baker Eddy claimed to be inspired by the Holy Spirit and writing her book. I don't believe there's a bit of inspiration about it. She even denied the atoning blood of Christ. And these people contradict one another. I've debated some of them who say Holy Ghost baptism is a part of the new birth. He denies that. Mr. Wells, I've debated him 5 times. And he says that the baptism of the Holy Ghost is a sense of new birth. And he testified that he has it and that he wasn't born again until he got it. Now just look at the difference in you fellows. You're not guided by the Holy Spirit and all things like the prophets were. The only way to be guided by the Holy Spirit is to be guided by the Word of God. But you're given by the Holy Spirit. And then again, tongues in Acts 10, yes, but they were not jabbering. They were speaking in a language, a foreign language to those 6 Jews. It says of those 6 Jews that they were astonished, for they heard them speak with the tongues and magnify God. Now, how did they know they were not blaspheming God? Because they understood them. They knew that what they were saying was magnifying God. This is a language that these 6 Jews understood. Now, they didn't understand the Greek language. They were just Jewish words. They came along not understanding Gentile language. And when these Gentiles began to speak in another tongue, these Jews understood it in their own tongue. And they were convinced that God's back of this, and therefore we ought to fellowship Gentiles. And we ought not to object to the baptism of these folks and fellowshipping them as Christians. Let them obey the gospel. First Gentiles to be converted under the Christian religion. Well, he said there'd be thousands in heaven,
who do not have the Holy Spirit? Let's see about that. What did he say about Jude 19? Essential, having not the Spirit. A man doesn't have the Spirit, he's essential. And he says nobody has it but those who have the baptism of the Spirit. But that isn't so. He has three baptisms. Water baptism, Holy Ghost baptism, and that imaginary baptism. Yet Paul said Ephesians 4 and 5, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. But he has five. And Paul said that after Holy Ghost baptism had served its purpose. And this imaginary baptism never did exist that he talks about. Acts 2:38, repent and be baptized, everyone out of the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, people have to do that to be saved, and when they're saved, God gives them the Holy Spirit. Acts 5:32, and so also is the Holy Ghost, whom God has given to them to obey him. And Romans 8 and 11, Paul said, I long to see you Romans, that I may impart of you some spiritual gift to the end you may be established. This miraculous importation of the Spirit by laying on of hands wasn't necessary to establish them, but they already had the Holy Spirit when he wrote that. Or down in the 8th chapter in the 9th verse, he said, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. This man says that isn't so. There are thousands, hundreds of thousands of people in heaven who never did have the Holy Spirit. The Bible says, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin. But the Spirit is life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him that raised up Christ from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your body by his Spirit that dwells in you. All the Christians in the New Testament times had the Holy Spirit. Unless they had apostatized and lost it. An essential and devilish habit, not the Spirit. So I challenge you to try to defend that false doctrine that Christians all over the world not having the Holy Spirit on the way to him. It isn't so. And then take a call in. He says, you are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. 1 Corinthians 3:16. It was in these people. He said it's in your bodies. In 1 Corinthians 6:18-19. And yet, he said, do all speak with tongues? Are all apostles? Do all prophesy? Do all speak with tongues? He means they do not. They all had the Holy Spirit that didn't speak with tongues, and yet he says you don't have the Holy Spirit unless you can speak with tongues. See the contradiction he's in? And then again, tongues edify. Yes, if a man comes in, he can speak in a tongue, and they're far in his presence, it edifies them. When the rest of the congregation could not have edified them unless they'd had tongues in that early day. Couldn't even have given them a copy of the New Testament in their own language, for it hadn't been written as yet first. And then some tongues are for the sign, says Paul, 1 Corinthians 14:22, to him that believeth not. If an unbeliever comes in and you can get up there and speak in his language and he knows you haven't learned that language, and you can preach to him in that and tell him about Jesus' love in that language, well, then that will be a sign to him. He'll confirm the gospel. They went forth and preached everywhere the Lord working with them and confirming the word of the sign followed. Mark 16:20. And part of that was speaking in tongues. It was to confirm the word as well as for the utility of it. And that's the purpose of it. And he said, Joel did not say, let the Spirit be poured out in the first part of the last days. Well, he did do it. Peter said he did. Peter said that it was fulfilled. This is that which is spoken by the prophet Joel and it shall come to pass in the last days. Peter said, this is it. And he denied it. Says it isn't so. And yet they talked with tongues right there.
1 minute.
And then again, he said some mocked back there. Yes, but they were mocking those who were really speaking in tongues. They were not mocking somebody up there jabbering. They had no such foolishness as that. And then the purpose of tongues was Christ gave the Great Commission. Go teach all nations. Preach the gospel to every creature. But people didn't all speak the same language. And neither did the apostles know all these different languages. So they had to have the power to speak to people in their own languages, and that power was given them from God Almighty. There was a purpose in it, a utility, a need. There's no purpose in here, foolishness. And therefore, I want to thank you very much for your good attention. And in the next speech, I want to give some. Next speech will be which speech? Third one? Be the third one. I'm going to, in my next speech, give some references to some reasons why that we have
the baptism of water continuing. Holy Spirit baptism served its purpose and has passed away. Is my time up? I want to thank you very much.